Coin toss to determine the order of the opening statements, and Ms. Cardinale will go first, followed by Andy Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, thank you for coming. You're on the clock.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. Before we start, I'd like to take a moment to send my condolences to the people of Chautauqua County. We've lost three people this weekend. I think we've lost a total of 13, and I don't believe that anyone has addressed this appropriately. To the families, I'm so sorry, and I'm here for you. And that's the reason that I'm here. My name is Christina Cardinale, and I am a working class citizen. I worked in the restaurant industry for 13 years, and I now own and operate my own sales and marketing consultant business. When I hear, and I hear it a lot, that I don't have the qualifications to be running for this position, good. I take that as a compliment. I don't want to qualify as a standard politician. I want to be a working person who represents working people. Working people are the ones that care about the politics of everything the most, because they are the ones that are the most effective, whether it be positive or negative. So I'd like to show you what a working person in politics looks like. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Mr. Goodell, you're on the clock.
Thank you very much. I'm running for re-election because I want to be able to use my background and my experience and my education to represent the residents in Chautauqua County as we face some of the most difficult issues in the history of the state of New York. Because of the COVID shutdown, the revenues in the state of New York have just plummeted. Estimates are that we are facing a $14.5 billion shortfall. So the decisions that are made in Albany over the next 2 years are going to have major impacts on each of you. And so we need to have someone in Albany representing us who's analyzing the laws, who has that budget experience that's so critical at this time, who's looking at what the short-term and the long-term ramifications are, and putting together the strategy so that we can come out of this crisis as strong as we can possibly be. Now, I grew up in a small home. I had four brothers, a two-bedroom house. There were seven of us in a house that was like 1,280 square feet. And throughout high school, I worked. In the summer, I ran a campground. In the winter, I plowed or shoveled snow. Throughout college, I worked. I worked in a pizza business with my cousin. We ran that during the summer. And in the winter, I tutored mathematics. And I worked throughout law school and eventually paid off all my law school loans. I know what it means to work hard, and I'm looking forward to taking that background that I have in the private sector as a managing partner of a law firm, my economics degree, and my law degree to represent you in Albany. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. We'll move on to our questions now, and each of us members of the media on our panel will be posing questions, and I'll open with the opening question, which was the only question that was provided for both of our candidates this evening. That question is, what is your solution to closing a $14.5 billion, that's with a B, billion-dollar budget deficit in New York State? And we'll begin with Andrew Goodell. Mr. Goodell?
The governor is currently projecting a $14.5 billion shortfall. And that's on the assumption that we don't get any federal assistance. I am confident that we will get a substantial amount of federal assistance, and we'll be able to close that budget gap for this year. The real challenge, though, is the budget that we have to vote on in the end of March. And that budget will be facing a huge shortfall. So my recommendations are that we focus on prioritizing the state spending and reduce it in all the areas that have lower priority. For example, I would recommend eliminating the tax credit of $420 million that we give to Hollywood millionaires to come every year to New York State. Eliminating $144 million, for example, for a ski upgrade and instead selling the state ski resorts, privatizing them, just like they are here in Chautauqua County, and using the $1 billion that we anticipate we could receive on that sale. I recommend we eliminate the $100 million that they put in for next year's budget for campaigns, your tax dollars paying for ads that you probably don't want to see for candidates you may not support. The biggest focus, though, we have to look at is reforming our welfare and Medicaid programs, because our Medicaid program in New York costs us more than Texas and Florida combined, over $13 billion more. So we need to bring our expenses in line so that we can close that gap and move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale.
So you want to make cuts to Medicaid and Medicare during a pandemic? Just checking that out. Okay. So to combat the deficit, first and foremost, I think that we absolutely need to get bailed out by the federal government. We need help from Washington, and I appreciate him bringing up that point because it's absolutely true. I do not like to talk about national politics during a state election because I don't want to get lost in the national politic area, but Mitch McConnell did in fact say that he will not be bailing out any blue states. He went on record to say, ain't gonna happen, in his Mitch McConnell way. I think that is something that absolutely needs to be addressed because we absolutely need help from Washington. When we're looking at things to reduce spending and we're looking at things to invigorate revenue, there are some things that I would like to look at that can help lower what we are going through and to help fix this gap that we're seeing right now. I would like to look at resentencing nonviolent offenders in New York State. And I say this with the understanding that we need to be very careful of who we are releasing. Nonviolent offenders, though, I will reiterate this, nonviolent, but I want to be careful that we're not putting people on the street. Most importantly, in terms of invigorating revenue, I would like to legalize cannabis for New York State. The revenue coming into the state will be significant, and there are a lot of different opportunities that will open up for recreational and also medicinal purposes.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. Mr. Goodell, you do have 60 seconds to rebut if you'd like.
Certainly. When you're facing a $14 billion shortfall that will likely hit us in next year's budget, it's important to look at every issue, including, you know, can we address prison populations and are there other revenue sources? But you have to look at the big picture. And the big picture is that when you look at the Medicaid costs we have in New York State, New York spends $74.8 billion compared to Florida's $23 billion, three times more. Texas, which is substantially larger than we are, spends half as much as we do on Medicaid. I am confident with the knowledge and the ability that we have in New York State that we can restructure our Medicaid program to provide high-quality health care and bring our average costs in line with California's, for example, which is what we need to do to save billions of dollars. And I'd rather do that than look at cutting education or other higher priority areas.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you have 60 seconds.
Healthcare and education are New York State's biggest spending factor. I don't know how long the pandemic is going to be going on. I don't want to make cuts to healthcare or education for the foreseeable future because we don't know what lies in the future. That is the plan for looking at resentencing nonviolent offenders, looking at legalizing cannabis, because I am trying to find creative ways without cutting our healthcare during a time that we're going to need it the most.
Thank you. Move on to our next question, and that will be asked by Terry Frank. Terry?
Thanks very much, Jason, and thank you, WRFA, for hosting this candidates forum. To the candidates, I want to mention that our state senator, George Borrello, has proposed legislation that would essentially divide New York State into three autonomous zones, having a certain degree of control over each of those zones, though it would remain one state. There have also been calls for making two or three states out of New York State. How do you feel about this, and do the positives outweigh the negatives? I will put this to Mr. Goodell first, because I know he has an opinion on this.
I do. First, let me talk about the political realities of asking all the Democrat assembly members from New York City that control the Democrat, that control the assembly, to vote to essentially eliminate their own position. Because if you split the New York state into New York City and other zones, then the New York City assembly members are nothing more than redundant city council members. And as much as I think we need to be treated separately, and I argue every time I'm on the floor about the importance of supporting and recognizing upstate and ensuring we have the right funding levels for upstate, we need to recognize that political reality. Second, you want to recognize that 20% of the state's revenues comes from Wall Street. And so we need to be very careful that we don't lose the revenue that's so helpful upstate. But having said that, the counterargument is that many times we wrestle with laws that are designed for New York City that create huge challenges for us upstate, whether it's business regulations, the workers' comp program, you know, a lot of our tax policies. And so it takes a thoughtful, long-term evaluation of the pros and cons before I would support it.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale?
I am not at all against finding ways to separate the state that are feasible, that would help counties like Chautauqua or help Western New York, because I do have the understanding that oftentimes we do suffer because of New York City. But we have to look at the sales tax revenue that we depend on coming from New York City. I would like to find a feasible way to actually split us if we are going to really sincerely talk about that, because everyone says that is in favor of this idea that we don't depend on the sales tax, but in fact, we do. But also, I would like to point out that this proposal will actually implement more government officials and more politicians. And as someone who would like less government, more limited government interference, I can't support something that would do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goodell, you do have 60 additional seconds if you would like to add on to what you had already said, or if you want to rebut what Ms. Cardinale had said.
I have been very fortunate that we've gotten an excellent group of bipartisan upstate legislators that work together to make sure that the upstate needs are heard in Albany on both sides of the aisle. And because of that, we were able to ensure that the budget, for example, includes fiscal parity between New York City and upstate when it comes to transportation aid, that it all doesn't go to the MTA. We were able successfully to get a different approach on the minimum wage, recognizing that the cost of living and the competitiveness of upstate is very different than New York City. We were able to get into a pretty firm commitment on allocating school aid to make sure that upstate gets more than its fair share. And so my approach is to continue to work across the aisle in a bipartisan manner with all of my upstate colleagues to make sure we maintain that fiscal parity.
Thank you. Any final thoughts, Ms. Cardinale? 60 seconds.
I think it's a little odd that you would mention your interest in minimum wage when every single chance that you had, you voted against raising minimum wage, especially for restaurant workers, because that was worked into there too. So I'm not quite sure how serious you are about benefiting the working people and talking about raising minimum wage and talking about your awareness of minimum wage and restaurant worker wage when there have been three different occasions that you have not supported increasing it by only a dollar.
Thank you. Before we move on, I want to apologize to my colleagues on the panel. I had wanted to rotate back and forth on who gets to go first, and with Mr. Goodell getting to answer two questions in a row first, Ms. Cardinale will get to answer the next two questions. That helps our folks in the producer's booth as well to know who's going to be asking the questions first. So with that being said, Ms. Cardinale will get to respond to the next two questions first, and the next question will be asked by Justin Gould. Justin?
Jason, thank you, and thank you to WRFA. The State House is primarily controlled by New York City politicians. With this in mind, how can you from rural Western New York be a force for the district, Ms. Cardinale?
Hi, it's nice to see you. Thank you for your question. I would like to remind everyone that when electing me, I will be joining the Democratic majority. That is a very important position to be in. It opens up a lot of doors within itself. And I've said this before, and I will say it again, when joining the Democratic majority, I have absolutely no issue verbalizing the needs for the people of Chautauqua County. I have no problem mouthing off if I have to, because I tend to be a little mouthy at times. I have no problem asserting myself into a situation to advocate for the people of Chautauqua County and the people of Western New York to truly make sure that the rural part of New York is getting the funding and the support that it deserves.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. Mr. Goodell.
It's obviously very important when we're on the floor of the Assembly that we work in a bipartisan manner. And the irony is that even though I'm the floor leader, which means I lead the debate for the Republicans, I have a great working relationship with my colleagues on the other side. And as a result, I can often get suggested amendments actually enacted by the state legislature because they would rather amend the bill to reflect my suggestions than to have to debate it. In addition, as I mentioned, we have already in existence a bipartisan upstate coalition. And that's really important when there are differences in issues between downstate and upstate. And we work very effectively together to make sure those differences are recognized. And you'll see it when you look at some of the controversial bills, including the minimum wage, which I'll just mention. The minimum wage, obviously, if it were only up to New York City, would be going up to $15. It's going up to $12.50 in New York, upstate New York. And the reason I oppose the increase in minimum wage is because the empirical data from high-quality economists was overwhelming that if you raise the minimum wage above the market clearing price, above what is normally in the community, you lose jobs. And we all see it, because when we go to a grocery store, we see all the self-checkouts because they are no longer working.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you have 60 seconds if you'd like to use them.
The real reason that you have never voted to raise minimum wage or take care of workers is because you have never worked an essential job, Mr. Goodell. You have no idea what it's like to eat your food over a trash can. You have no idea what it's like to have shin splints and feet that are bleeding while you run around and try to serve tables and be in a hot kitchen and be verbally abused by not only managers and customers. I think if you had more of a working class experience, you would advocate on behalf of those like me who are in that position.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. You do have 60 seconds, Mr. Goodell, if you'd like to rebut one final time.
Certainly. It's amazing when I'm accused of not having an essential job. Throughout college, my cousin and I ran a pizza business. And that means we had a huge oven. We were on our feet all day long. We served thousands of pieces of pizza. I used to say we made a lot of dough, but not a lot of money. And we traveled all over. And of course, in my private sector business, working long hours. My typical work day used to be 8 to 6, 10 hours a day. Now that I've gotten older, I've cut back, so it's more like 8:30 to 5:30, you know, plus evening events. I've worked all my life, and it's those life experiences that I take to Albany. The experience of making payroll, the experience of working hard for yourself, the experience of analyzing bills from a legal perspective using my legal background. That's the experience I want to take in, including my hands-on work throughout my career.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Moving along, the next question will be posed by Terry Frank, and Ms. Cardinale will get to go first again. Terry, your question.
Thank you, Jason. Over the past few days, there has been a social media spat between the two of you over an August 2019 discovery of parking barriers in a Jamestown parking lot shaped as a swastika. Mr. Goodell responded in a newspaper article following that about it. However, Ms. Cardinale has been critical of that response. What should it have been, in your view? And I would also like to ask Mr. Goodell to respond to that.
First and foremost, I would like to point out that what I posted is not a smear campaign. A smear campaign would be if I completely fabricated something and tried to push it in order to defame you. That's not what I did. I took direct quotes from the article and I disagreed with them because I don't agree with passively acknowledging that you found a swastika in a business. First, I would like to suggest, who are these business owners that found the swastika? Because they wouldn't come forward. They wouldn't go on record to comment. Are they Jewish? Because that makes a huge difference. If this just so happened to be a swastika there, was it a targeted attack toward these people? That should have been established, and I think that is Mr. Goodell's job to reach out to those people and to make sure that this wasn't a hate crime. Secondly, if you're going to be quoted in the newspaper about finding a swastika, don't say, hey, it was probably just some kids, because even if it was, that does not give the correct impression. It's not okay. Call it a hate symbol. Recognize it as a symbol of hate. Tell the community that it has no place in our peaceful city of Jamestown.
Thank you. Andy, you have 90 seconds.
So I should be absolutely clear that I unequivocally oppose anyone putting up a swastika or any other symbol that is hateful. So this particular story arose when I got a call out of the blue from a newspaper reporter asking me my thoughts about this swastika that had been created by moving parking bumpers into the shape of a swastika. And I pointed out that the use of a swastika represents a horrific time period in our world's history where millions of innocent people were killed. I don't think anyone should think that that statement is supportive of the use of a swastika. I was then quoted in the same newspaper articles going on to say, the swastika is not only an affront to all the Jewish residents that were murdered, but it's also an affront to all of our veterans who risked their lives fighting against that very regime. In case you're not sure, the definition of affront means an action or remark that creates outrage or offense.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you do have 60 seconds.
Thank you for defining the term affront, because I've already done that repeatedly. We all know that affront means to cause outrage or disdain or offense. That is exactly my point. I have your quote right here, actually. It's an affront not only to the Jewish residents who were mass murdered, but it's an affront to all the veterans in the United States that fought in World War II. That's not good enough. It's not. It's a symbol of hate. Call it a symbol of hate. Don't call it an affront. An affront would be if I took a big black magic marker and I drew something disgusting on this wall that isn't a hate symbol, and I'm sure that you can use your imagination. Do not call it an affront, because throughout your entire quote right here that I have in front of me, you never once said that it's a hate symbol. Maybe if you looked a little more like me, you would understand the importance of condemning hate in our community.
Mr. Goodell, you do have 60 seconds.
So all of us who are in public service understand that from time to time we'll get a call out of the blue asking us for our comment on some subject. And we are really fortunate here in Chautauqua County that our news media are such high quality and do such a great job. But none of our news media have the space available or the time available to quote us completely when we talk for a half an hour over how upset we are over something that's occurred in the community. And so I am not in any way criticizing the fact that the reporter summarized my statements, and I stand by my statements. The word affront means create outrage. How much clearly can I, more clearly can I express that a swastika creates outrage, and it should create outrage because of what it represents?
Then use the word hate.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. We'll move along, and we will have Justin Gould ask the next question, and Mr. Goodell will get to respond first. Justin?
Thank you, Jason. Let's move back to current events. What can you do to help those in the community struggling from the COVID-19 pandemic?
Yes, great question. So my office works every week helping constituents with issues related to COVID-19. During the initial phases, our unemployment system was absolutely overwhelmed with applications. My office helped over 300 people cut through the bureaucracy and help them get their unemployment benefits. And I have a phenomenal staff, and my chief of staff does a great job, and I am so thankful. And we were working. I'd come in at 8, and she'd leave at 7 or 8, and we were working that whole time. Even after that, we've worked very closely with businesses and industry. We coordinate oftentimes their inquiries with the economic development people who are developing the regulations. You may recall that Senator Barella and I set forth a regional reopening plan, which was actually adopted by the governor. It was phenomenal. I mean, we sent it in on a Thursday. The following Tuesday, he had it up on a screen behind him, focusing on how we can help the businesses that are hurt with COVID reopening. I started out the day on the phone talking to the legislative liaison for the Education Department to expedite some licensing for people who are working in addressing the COVID situation. So whether it's individuals who are seeking unemployment or licensing or businesses, we're there on the front line helping them.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale.
Could you please repeat the question?
Yeah. What can you do as an elected official to help people struggling through the COVID-19 pandemic?
Thank you. There was a lot going on there, so I actually kind of forgot what the question was. I think we should talk about childcare. Seriously, let's talk about childcare, because it was very hard to get and very hard to maintain, before the pandemic, and now it is unbearable. I have a plan for childcare because I've truly looked into this, because it truly matters to me. I want to look at childcare as a business, a serious business. As of right now, as a society, when we talk about childcare, it's kind of like, oh, childcare. But let's really, really sincerely treasure childcare and treat it like a small business. And with that being said, I want to expand what qualifies as a deductible business expense for childcares to give them incentive and to help them out as a business. And secondly, I would like to look at our employers and the way that they offer working families FSAs. What an FSA is they will take money out of your paycheck, set it aside. We do this for healthcare a lot. I'm not sure if everyone is familiar with this. They take money out of your paycheck, put it aside, and that money does not have taxes on it. So you can continue to file money into a fund that is tax-free, and it's intentional so that you can then use that sum of money toward, and it would be, for childcare. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. Mr. Goodell, you do have 60 seconds.
Well, first, let me start out by saying I agree with my opponent that childcare is very important and is an important part of our economy. And that's why, right at the beginning, I was so pleased that New York State received over $160 million from the Federal CARES Act specifically for childcare. But I was dismayed when the governor only released about $30 million of it. And so I picked up on all the recommendations that were made by the Child Care Task Force. I sent a letter to the governor urging that to be released. I followed it up with press conferences. I worked with my colleagues and sent in a letter co-signed by both Republicans and Democrats, authored initially by Andrew Hevesy, the Democrat ranker on or chair of the Social Services Committee. And finally, those funds were released.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you do have 60 seconds.
I would like to point out that, yes, you did get some funding released, but your overall relationship with the governor leaves a lot to be desired. I don't agree with all of the things that the governor does. I don't agree with his decisions quite often. I don't agree with a lot of things that he has done during the pandemic. However, I understand the importance of working together. And every time I open a newspaper, I am on the internet, all I see is our current representative fighting our governor over and over and sending him offensive letters and bad-mouthing him and talking badly about him. And I'd like to reiterate the importance that you have to work together in order to find solutions. I don't think that you're currently doing that, and I think that you are denying us of what we need because you do not have a solid relationship with the governor or the Democrats of the Assembly.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. We'll move along, and Terry Frank will ask the next question, and Ms. Cardinale will get to go first. Terry?
Bail reform remains a hot-button issue in New York State. There was some moves, legislation to change the law, but essentially it remains in place. What actions would you take to try and get the legislature to at least give judges more discretion, that is, to set bail for offenders? Ms. Cardinale.
Thank you for the question. I would like to point out that bail reform did have the best of intentions, which is something that we often see in New York State. There is something implemented or proposed that really truly does intend to help, but the execution is poor because that is something that you always risk when you are proposing legislation. You have good intentions, then there is unexpected outcomes. With bail reform, the intention was to help people that could not pay bail because sometimes if you are living at the poverty level, $500 in bail is going to seal your fate and there's no way you're getting out. So often we are seeing with bail reform that people are being released that simply should not be released. And I would like to find a way to completely restore the judge's discretion in these cases. So if you're looking at someone who is stealing because they are struggling, and you are looking at someone who is stealing because they feel like it, that judge would be able to say, okay, this person is poor and this person needs help, as opposed to this person is going off and stealing and causing trouble. So there needs to be a very solid delineation between a judge's discretion so that they can weigh in. We can do that by advocating for more funding, having an assembly person who will advocate for more funding for the DA's office in Chautauqua County, and we can do that by relying on judges to completely involve themselves in making a case-by-case decision on these particular cases.
Thank you. Mr. Goodell?
I've introduced legislation to actually reform where we are with bail now. And the legislation I've introduced gives judges broad discretion, as recommended by Ms. Cardinale, but it also allows the judges to consider how dangerous the individual is to others in the community and to the community at large. That standard, by the way, that I outlined in the legislation tracks the federal bail reform legislation that was successfully implemented several years ago. And until now, until it would be adopted, New York would be the only state that doesn't consider how dangerous a defendant is. But my legislation goes on and addresses what the real underlying problem was that drove the initial bail efforts. And the real problem is that sometimes a person would be arrested for a relatively minor crime, there'd be a relatively low bail, they had no money, and they'd sit in jail on a small crime. And they'd sit in jail for a long time. And so my legislation addresses the real issue by requiring judges to review on a regular scheduled basis anyone who hasn't been able to make bail to evaluate whether or not if they pled guilty, for example, that they would just get time served. And so for a Class A misdemeanor, it'd be every 4 weeks, every 6 weeks for a Class E felony, and so on.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you have 60 seconds.
Okay, please answer me fast because this is technically my time. Are you saying that this is a sponsored bill of yours or a co-sponsored?
Oh, no, I drafted it.
It's your sponsored bill?
Yes.
Could you please cite this bill? Because I have a full record of your sponsored bills here, and I can't find it.
No, it's pending an index number from the clerk. But I'm happy to forward a full copy of the bill for you.
You don't keep a record of everything that you've sponsored with you when you're in a debate?
Oh, absolutely. And I'm happy to give you a copy right now if you'd like. I mean, this is a summary.
Where is this? What committee is it in?
Well, a bill is first gets an index number, and then after it gets an index number, it's assigned to a committee. And so this bill will most likely go to either the Judiciary Committee or the Rules Committee before being considered further. Now, I gave you the front page summary of the memo. The actual bill runs about 42 pages.
So you haven't actually proposed this in the Assembly?
Oh, yeah. It's waiting for an index number. It's already been submitted. It's already signed and submitted.
Ms. Cardinale, your time is up. Mr. Goodell, you're welcome to continue the dialogue back and forth if you'd like, but you do have 60 seconds to use as you'd like or not use it at all. Your call.
No, I just soon use it. Every time we have an issue that comes up, what I try to do as your representative in Albany is to read the proposed legislation very carefully and think about what the ramifications may be. Because sometimes there's a great idea behind the bill, but there's drafting problems or unanticipated negative consequences. And so when this bill came up that eliminated bail, by the way, for like 400 serious crimes, I understood what the issue was. And the issue was people who weren't being reviewed on a regular basis. Unfortunately, when they eliminated bail for all these serious crimes, we saw a huge spike in crime. The number of shootings in New York City now is double what it was a year ago. And so the solution was not the right solution for the problem, and I think the legislation that I've drafted is the right solution, and because it recognizes the legitimate concerns, I'm hoping it'll gain bipartisan support.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. We'll move on to at least one more question here, and that will be posed by Justin Gould. And Mr. Goodell, you will get to go first. Justin?
Thank you, Jason. Ms. Cardinale, you have said that you'd like to see the so-called red flag laws amended here in New York State, while Mr. Goodell, you've been a very loud opponent to the laws. What changes would you like to see if you're sent back to Albany or sent to Albany for the first time?
I start?
Yes.
Okay. So the concept on a red light law, the concept of the red flag law was to try to identify people that would be dangerous. And concept, I mean, we don't want people who are really dangerous to have guns and be out there shooting people, right? The problem is when they drafted it, it was extraordinarily broad without adequate due process protections. So for example, the legislation they voted on, and I voted against, would allow the police to seize somebody's guns based on a complaint from an ex-spouse, ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend, an ex-roommate that was not even under oath. Not even under oath. And there was no opportunity for a hearing right away. The hearing wouldn't occur until days later. And the standard on which they would use was a very, very low standard. And so the concept was good, but the execution and the language was bad. And what I do as your legislator is I actually read all the bills. I don't stop at the title. I read all the bill, and I evaluate it, and then I reach out to others in the field for their expertise and their information. And so the concept is right, but it should not be triggered by unverified statements. We need adequate due process, and we need to protect both the citizens and the owner of the gun.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale?
By the way, I just read this paper that you gave me, and there's no bill number on this whatsoever, so this could literally just be a fabrication, and that's all I'm going to say about that. When I was talking about the SAFE Act, I said I would like the SAFE Act amended. I agree overall with the red flag laws that if they infringe on due process, that's not something that I'm going to support, but I want to make sure that those laws in place are not infringing on anyone. But also I would like to point out that no one in Chautauqua County truly enforces red flag laws. The Sheriff's Department does not go out looking, or JPD, or anyone, any police department. They don't go looking for people to prosecute for something like that. In terms of the SAFE Act, I believe the SAFE Act was implemented very hastily with the impression that criminals will follow the rules. So I do not agree with, there are certain modifications that can be made to a weapon that are purely cosmetic and they do absolutely nothing, and that makes those guns not allowed. I don't agree with that. I also don't agree with the fact that if my father dies, God forbid, he's not allowed to let me inherit his guns, because that's how I learned to shoot, and I have some of the best memories that I have with him. I don't agree with that. I would like to sincerely sit down and truly evaluate the SAFE Act. If there's nothing of value in the SAFE Act, it should be repealed. If it prevents mass murder, if it prevents people from shooting up schools, and if there's any part of it that prevents murder, then it should remain but be amended. If it's useless, we should get rid of it.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. Mr. Goodell, 60 seconds.
When it comes to gun legislation, there's a lot of emotion and a lot of politics in Albany, driven primarily by New York City legislators, where gun violence is rampant. But what's ironic is that their solutions haven't reduced gun violence. It's actually doubled in the last year. Because what did they do? They eliminated bail for a vast majority of crimes. And those individuals are back out on the street. They eliminated judicial discretion. They've done nothing that effectively takes guns off the streets in dangerous neighborhoods. They're actually talking, and not just talking, they actually cut the police department in New York City by over $1 billion. Now, we're lucky here in Chautauqua County that we have high-quality police. We're lucky here in Chautauqua County that we have a lot of hunters that know how to use a gun safely. That's the right approach, not the approach they're taking.
Ms. Cardinale, 60 seconds.
That was a very long-winded response, for I've never met a woman who is also a Democrat that loves guns and feels the same way I do about the SAFE Act, so I'm just going to continue to talk on and on because I don't want to admit that the Democratic woman next to me loves guns just as much as I do.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. We will move on to another portion, the next portion of our debate. We do give the candidates an opportunity to pose questions to one another. It's time now for that part of the debate, and the respondent will have 90 seconds to respond to the question, and the questioner has up to 60 seconds for a rebuttal, and the respondent will then have 30 seconds for a final rebuttal. With that being said, Ms. Cardinale, do you have a question for Mr. Goodell?
I do. My time hasn't started yet, has it?
You don't have any time limit for asking the question, but Mr. Goodell does have 90 seconds to respond.
Beautiful.
Let's hope the question is not longer than 90 seconds.
Mr. Goodell, I have here a record, a news record that I've printed out. It is available online, and this did in fact happen in 1993 when I was 4, but I believe that we should speak about it. I'd like to read you this. Legislator Frederick Larson of Jamestown, the assistant minority leader, said his party will submit a motion at the next legislative session condemning County Executive Andrew Goodell for his part in tax snooping. State revenue agents copied license plates of New York shoppers in the Warren and Mill Creek, Pennsylvania malls. The tax department sent letters to the car owners explaining that a state law requires New York residents to pay New York sales tax on items purchased in Pennsylvania. The action brought cries of outrage from county residents who blamed Big Brother for what they considered an invasion of privacy. Larson noted.
Ms. Cardinale, can you get to the question? We are short on time.
I'm going to finish this. Larson noted that legislator Robert Boother, who is a Republican, had suggested any public official guilty of, quote, breach of faith should be, quote, hanged outside the courthouse. He said that about you. Can you please explain why you snooped on Chautauqua County residents and sent them letters saying that they owe New York State money?
Mr. Goodell, 90 seconds.
Sure. So 27 years ago, I was almost as young as my opponent is today. And thankfully, as we get older, we get wiser, hopefully, and we learn from mistakes and we move forward. Just to correct things, by the way, when I was county executive, I did not run the state tax department and I did not send anyone over. They were all state employees. But I pointed out to the state tax department that, look, if you want to know who's shopping outside the state and not paying the state sales tax as required by law, it's no secret. You know how to figure it out. But what happened next is the most important aspect. What happened next is with the support of Senator Present and our assemblyman, Bill Parmet, we were able to get through the state legislature legislation that allowed the county to eliminate the sales tax completely on clothing. And when we did, you saw an explosion of retail growth here in Chautauqua County. That's when they renovated the Chautauqua County Mall. That's when they put on hold the retail development that was going on in Warren. And what's amazing is when we eliminated the sales tax on clothes in Chautauqua County, our retail sales went up by over $10 million, and our net sales tax revenue went up. So that's a lesson that I've learned. If you want to have the state prosper, you need to make sure your tax structure is competitive, and that's my mission moving forward.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, 60 seconds.
Okay, don't talk about Bill Parmet like he's your friend, because you're not friends at all, and I have no idea why you'd use that man's name, the best assembly person that we have ever had. You have no right to talk about Bill Parmet like you're buddies. And this did, in fact, happen, and your excuses that you have just proceeded to give us doesn't change the fact that you approached the tax commissioner and had lead investigators follow people around in Chautauqua County, follow them to Pennsylvania, see what they were buying, have them come back, and then you sent them letters telling them that they owed the state money. Your own GOP majority leader said that you should be hung outside the courthouse, as inappropriate as that is, and you inspired outrage. As our county executive, they said you were big brother. I'm not sure why you're in the position that you're in now if you have a tendency to do this type of thing.
30 seconds, Mr. Goodell.
Well, I love talking about what happened over a quarter of a century ago.
Doesn't matter.
But I'm here now focused on what we can do in the future. And my mission representing you in Albany is to eliminate the need for any of that type of enforcement action by bringing New York State's tax structure in line with our neighboring states.
So you admitted it.
And that's exactly what happened out of that instance.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. We'll move along to your opportunity to ask a question of Ms. Cardinale, if you have one.
Sure. Looking to the future, what would be your top legislative priority if you're elected as assemblywoman to represent us here in Chautauqua County?
90 seconds, Ms. Cardinale.
Chautauqua County has a poverty rate of 18.5 that was before the pandemic. Over 60% of households with single women with children are on the poverty line. Jamestown Public Schools just recently announced that 70% of their school families are at the poverty line. All of the families in Casadega receive free lunch and are currently not receiving the electronic benefits card they are supposed to be receiving to have food every day. Our county is struggling, and it struggled before the pandemic. We have no public transportation. We're lacking infrastructure in the places that we need it the most. I love the Comedy Center deeply. I really do. But when you're on 2nd Street and you look at the Comedy Center at this millions and millions of dollars, you go down 2nd Street and people can't even afford to find groceries because they technically live in a food desert. And I don't like to use that word because it implies that things are stagnant and they can't grow there. And I understand the implication behind that. but there is a lot of inequality and there's a lot of inequity, and people deserve better. People deserve an advocate who will go to the assembly and demand, when they talk to the speaker, that you will take care of my county.
60 seconds, Mr. Goodell.
Thank you. And I think poverty is a very serious and a very important issue. And it's one that I've been focusing on and working on. And thankfully, it's one where we've had a lot of really smart, talented people here in Chautauqua County working on as well. I was delighted when Chautauqua County was a recipient of $1 million ESPRI grant, Empire State Poverty Reduction Initiative. And I was one of the few assemblymen who actually met and worked on that, hands-on, on the ground, to make initiatives here in Jamestown that can reduce poverty. Just yesterday, we had a great presentation from the Chautauqua Leadership Network. Some of you may know that I was one of the founding members, all focused on poverty and what we can do to address it. And I have several legislative pieces all focused on welfare reform to make it easier for a person to leave welfare and become successful.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, you do have 30 seconds.
Where is it? Where are the funds that you're talking about? Where is the help, the assistance for people? Because I look around and I see a lot of suffering, and I see, like I said, food deserts, and I see families that don't have access to fresh produce, and I see Jamestown Public Schools not being able to take care of their children that the way that they need to because of lack of funding. Like I said, there are giant inequalities. Just in the city of Jamestown alone, we have this big downtown revitalization, and a few feet down the street, they're struggling. So I don't see what you're talking about. I don't see your efforts that you're claiming to be making, because I actually talk to these people.
Man, the time is up, and we are out of time in terms of the questions we have for our candidates, as well as the time that the candidates have to ask questions of one another, although we could continue this afterward, but we are on a schedule, and we have to wrap up our debate shortly. So with that being said, we will get to our closing statements. It's time for each candidate to make a closing remark, and we will go in reverse order of opening remarks. With that said, Mr. Goodell, you have 2 minutes. Final words?
Thank you very much. I'm very thankful that we're here with our top news media in Southern Chautauqua County in the first of 3 debates. And I'm very thankful that I've been able to represent the residents of Chautauqua County in Albany. And over the years, I've been very thankful as well that I've been able to rise to a leadership position. And I currently serve as a minority floor leader on the floor of the Assembly. And as that In that role, I review every bill that comes up for a vote. And I don't stop at the title. I analyze the language and the ramifications. And I am so thankful that I have that legal background that enables me to read complex legislation, and an economics background, and a private sector background. And I draw on all that background and experience to represent the residents in Chautauqua County. And they cannot have a person who speaks more, because there's no one else on the floor that speaks more than I do. But I do it in a respectful manner, and I focus on the issues. And because I focus on the issues and not on personalities, I have a great working relationship with my Democrat colleagues and with the governor, which is why the governor backed the Athenix project for $200 million. And why we got funding here for the Comedy Center, over $40 million, and why we got the ESPRI poverty grant. And over, I work with the governor to put Chautauqua County residents first. And I am thankful when the governor does something that I support, like enacting our regional redevelopment plan, reopening plan, right? When the governor does it, I publicly thanked him. On the other hand, when he does something I think he should have reconsidered, I let him know that too. And I will continue to put the residents of Chautauqua County first in everything I do in Albany.
Thank you, Mr. Goodell. Ms. Cardinale, 2 minutes.
Thank you. I'm going to address what you just said, and I'm going to take up my own time to address this because the people deserve to know the truth. The Athenix project that you always talk about and you are so proud of, you had nothing to do with. When it came down to it, you could not bring home the bacon, Mr. Goodell. And Mayor Willie Rosas, as spirited as he is, went to the assembly, he went to the speaker, and he advocated for that funding, and he got that funding put into the budget. It had nothing to do with you, and you fall back on that every time to say that you're creating jobs and you're doing so many great things for working people. But when it comes down to it, Mayor Willie did that, not you. Now, on to my closing statement. You talk about how you are actually listening to your constituents and how concerned you are. Let's see what some of them have to say. Quote, I will be really honest. On the last election, I voted for my brother in Christ, Andy Goodell. I will not be voting for him this November. He represented me. I trusted this man to help me, but all he did was cover his own ass. From a woman named Bonnie. Quote, Andy Goodell was one of the few that voted against opening birth certificates for adult adoptees, and I am one of them. He seems to want the past to just stay there. From a woman named Kim. And finally, Andy Goodell suggested I should have to get a special license to use the ladies' restroom because I'm transgender. Of course, not even convicted sex offenders are registered to do this. As far as LGBTQ rights are concerned, Goodell is against them. He has been for years. This has directly harmed my life. And that was from a woman named Helen. I might be a newcomer, and you might think that I don't have the experience that you do, but I know right from wrong. And I hope everyone will seriously consider how much pain must be out there in Chautauqua County because of this man right here. I hope you bring this info with you on Election Day.
Thank you, Ms. Cardinale. We are out of time. I will remind our listeners and those viewing that there will be other debates in the future, two other ones, as far as I know, that are scheduled. And, of course, both candidates will welcome you to reach out and pose questions to them as well. So the election is coming up, and we still have plenty of time to talk about the issues. But we're out of time tonight, and that will do it for our program. Again, we want to thank our two candidates for State Assembly for taking part, Christina Cardinale and Andrew Goodell. And thank you to our host and presenter for tonight, the Reginald A. Center for the Arts, WRFA, along with the Chautauqua Region Community Foundation for funding our live video stream. I also want to thank my two colleagues, Justin Gould, as well as Terry Frank. Our technical director for tonight was Kip Reynolds on video and Ed Tomasini on audio, in consultation with WRFA General Manager Dennis Drew and Reginald A. Center for the Arts General Executive Director Hillary Myers. Don't forget that early voting in Chautauqua County begins October 24th, and Election Day is on Tuesday, November 3rd. For more information, contact the Chautauqua County Board of Elections at votechautauqua.com. I'm WRFA Public Affairs Director Jason Sample, saying thank you for listening or watching, and don't forget to vote if you haven't already done so. Have a good evening.